Call the roll.
Commissioner Hitterdale? Commissioner Rush? Commissioner Marashi?
Here.
Vice Chair Schaefer?
Here.
Chair Christie?
You're here.
Oh, I'm here. I'm sorry. It didn't sound like Christie. I'm sorry, it didn't.
Commissioner Hardy?
Here.
Commissioner Tardif?
Here.
Commissioner Nguyen? For the record, Commissioner Nguyen and Commissioner Rush have requested an excused absence. Chair, you have quorum.
Yes. Both of them have, one's out, Commissioner Nguyen is out of the country on business, and Commissioner Rush is has a business conflict. As we know, jobs come before commission, right? Okay. Thank you so much. May I ask Commissioner Hardy to lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance, please? Would you all please stand?
I pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thank you so much. Now, moving on with our agenda, we're coming to the phase of public comments. This means of any items that it's not agendized, okay? You're here for an agendized item, but this is something that's not on our agenda that you, the public, would love for us to come up and talk to us about. We can't take any action on it, but you want something to bring to our attention, please fill out a little yellow slip for any public comments, please. And also, we do validate parking, so make sure you get your little parking ticket, okay? All right, do we have any comments from the public? Going once? Okay. I understand. Okay, moving forward. Okay, on our consent calendar, we'd like to have a motion to approve the minutes of the regular meeting held October 26, 2017. There a motion?
I move we approve the consent calendar,
which includes the minutes from the adjourned regular scheduled meeting October 26, minutes of the special meeting held on November 9th. We'll take the excused absence after that. Just on the minutes. Moved by Commissioner Schaefer.
Second.
Second by Commissioner Rushke. All in favor say aye.
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 All those opposed? Motion carried with Commissioner Rush and Nguyen absent.
And okay. Could you note me as abstaining because I wasn't
and
there?
And abstaining to Commissioner Tardif. He was not here. Speaking of that, let's just continue on. The excused absence of Commissioner Nguyen and Commissioner Rush. Is there a motion?
I make the motion. We excuse the two absences.
I'll second.
All those in favor say aye.
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 I'm not sure if I... Yeah. I'm a representative. Am I a voting representative?
Yes.
Then I'll vote aye.
Yes. We're going to welcome you next day. Okay. Motion moved with the absence of Commissioner Rush and Commissioner Nguyen. And speaking of, it's with heartful sadness that I must report that Commissioner Garcia, who has been a long member of this commission, has decided to step down due to conflict with working schedules and so forth. But we're happy to have back with us Commissioner Mike Tardif, who is here and in another capacity and representing another area. But he's now with us now representing community housing and redevelopment.
Community redevelopment and housing.
On that. So welcome back.
Thank you, Chair Christie. Thank you all, fellow commissioners.
And
glad to be back.
And I would like to take the privilege of directing staff to please send a letter or something to Commissioner Garcia for her long work that she has done with this commission and valuable input that she had on this commission. If you would do that, I'd greatly appreciate it. Okay. Now, moving next, item number D is the Historic Property Preservation Agreement number 2017-37 Mills Act with Gia Hung Nguyen for the property located at 2009 North Baker Street. And Gia Hung Nguyen, applicant. Is there a motion? And you have to read it.
Is that not part of the consent?
Well, we're taking this one.
So, Madam Chair, I move that we adopt the staff recommendation on this to authorize the city manager and the president of council to execute the historic property preservation agreement specified in item D of the consent calendar.
Moved by Commissioner Larry Llewellyn. Hitterdell, I'm sorry, Hitterdell. And is there a second?
I make a second motion.
Second by Commissioner Marashki. All those in favor say aye.
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 Chair Christie, could I make a comment on that? I'll be voting aye, but I know I got the book, of course, on short notice, but that's understandable. I didn't know until last night that I would be on this commission. I looked on Google and I saw the home as much as I could, Google Street View. It's a beautiful home, but there are three large trees that kind of tend to block the view, and I would just make the comment that if the homeowner had the opportunity to maybe trim the trees or...
I can speak to that.
Yes.
Okay, Commissioner.
I live in that neighborhood, and I have noticed not only have they done a lot of extensive renovation work and painting and things that needed to be done, but they've also dramatically trimmed back the trees. So the house is very visible today. In fact, I think one of the trees they removed.
Excellent.
So
thank
you. Looks a lot better.
Thank you, Commissioner.
Okay. Thanks. All those in favor say aye.
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 Opposed? Motion carried with the absence of Commissioner Nguyen and Commissioner Rush. Okay, that's the end of the consent business calendar items. Communication disclosure, Commissioner, disclosures. Commissioner Hitterdale?
Yes, this will be relative to item number one. Following the invitation we received to talk to the applicant, I did call the applicant, the Met Development Company, and spoke briefly with Kevin Coleman. And he just outlined to me in general what they're planning to do and offered to answer any questions if I had them. At that time, I hadn't viewed the property in detail yet, so I did go out and see it, but I didn't have any questions, didn't have any subsequent conversations.
Okay. Commissioner Marashki?
Sunday afternoon, Chairperson Alberta Christie and myself went and visited all the homes. Nobody was home except for the ones on Lacey Street, who we had the pleasure of speaking with, and we're here tonight and got to tour the inside and all that stuff. So it was a wonderful time. Also, I will be abstaining from the vote when it comes to the property on Flower Street because Susan lives directly across from myself, and I helped her with some of the paperwork and the previous owners.
I noted that. You just walked across the street, and that's item number. You know, remember the item?
That is going to be item number five.
Item number five. Okay.
And I have two disclosures. One is regarding the property on Heliotrope. I had extensive conversations with the applicant prior to her purchasing the home and during the process. and with Holly Sobolewski, who's no longer on staff. So that was several months ago. And then also today I had a conversation with the applicant for our first item, and that is the McFarland House and that project.
Any other disclosures?
Yes, I have a disclosure. Just that I did go by each property and just looked at it from my car.
Very good. Okay. Very good. Now, moving on the business calendar. This is now the time and the place for public hearing item number one for the historical exterior modification application number 2017-01 and historic exterior modification application number 2017-02. Staff will now make a presentation and introduce yourself. New staffer. Hi.
Yes. Good afternoon, Madam Chair and members of the Historic Resources Commission. My name is Selena Kelleher and I'm an associate planner here with the City of Santa Ana. The application before you tonight is brought forth by Net Development Company with the request to permit exterior modifications to the historic structure located at 2115 North Main Street and to relocate the historic structure currently at 2056 North Bush Street to Main Street and permit exterior modifications. The request for the exterior modifications is part of a larger development project known as the Hampton Inn Hotel. It would be a new hotel project, 6 stories in height, with an outdoor pool, parking lot, and on-site amenities for the hotel. That's where the two historic structures come into play, as they would be proposed to be reused as a restaurant with a new outdoor dining deck. The applicant has strategically designed these site plans and building elevations to minimize the number of exterior modifications proposed for the project, and staff will also be reviewing these specifications as far as any new materials to make sure that it matches in character of the existing historic structures. Here's an aerial photo of the location of the structures. 2115 is the location of the McFarland House, which is off of Main Street, and 2056 North Bush Street is the location of the Melton House, which is currently located on Bush Street. The property at 2056 North Bush is proposed to be relocated to Main Street in the approximate area shown in white. And I'll go into the historic structures themselves. The McFarland House is at 2115 North Main Street. It was placed on the city's register as a good example of a craftsman bungalow style architecture and a good resource to the city of Santa Ana. The proposed alterations to the structure are in regards to the north elevation. The applicant proposes to remove the non-original staircase leading to the second floor. The second story door would remain with a secured landing and handrail at the second story. At the ground level, two windows would be removed and replaced with glass panel wood doors, and site improvements including an outdoor dining deck, which would be detached from the structure, would also be placed there. The door placement was picked by the applicant in order to eliminate the number of openings that would be needed if they were to put a new door in a different location. And the outdoor deck is raised to allow ADA access in and out of the buildings, eliminating the need for a lift or wider door openings. The Melton House at 2056 North Bush Street is listed on the city's register. It is a good example of a minimalist colonial revival style house that was typical of the 1920s. This house is proposed to be relocated from Bush Street to Main Street. It would be rotated 180 degrees so that the front door and porch would be the primary elevation seen from Main Street. And the placement and spatial relationships of the two historic structures is what would be typical to something of the time as seen along Main Street. The applicant will also submit a relocation plan in accordance with John Obed Curtis's moving historical buildings for staff review and submit that prior to any relocation or building permit issuance. and an architectural historian will be obtained or other professional that meets the Secretary of Interior standards during the relocation process at all times to ensure that everything is done in accordance with the relocation plan and the Secretary of Interior standards. To go through the elevations for the Melton House, there would be a new pool deck adjacent to the house, therefore the crawl space fence would no longer be visible from view, as seen on as the comparison of the existing elevations to the proposed new elevations. In regards to the south elevation, this would be the elevation between the two historic structures and adjacent to the new outdoor dining deck. The pair of hung windows would be removed and the window trim would be extended down to the ground. There would be a new single door with side light, which would fit exactly in the window location. So it would be a total of four windows removed and two new doors added. At the rear of the structure, this would be the interior of the property from the hotel site parking lot. The new ADA ramp would be added. The handrails would be minimal in style so that the historic structures are what a view versus the primary view versus any of the on-site improvements. And the primary street elevation would be the new west elevation. The steps on each side of the stoops would be removed, and additional steps would be added to the front to allow the steps to extend down to the new adjacent grades. In addition, a new foundation would be placed for the structure and a wall between the two historic structures to create an outdoor dining area. Staff has reviewed the plans and in consultation with an architectural historian to review the conformance with the Secretary of Interior standards, and does believe that the plans as proposed meet the standards. Concerns have been raised that the wall and the mural between the two historic structures creates a commercial setting, while the original use of the structures were residential uses. However, the wall has been set back behind the two historic structures so that the primary front elevations remain the prominent features along Main Street. The materials, features, finishes, and craftsmanship overall of the two historic structures will be preserved as no additional modifications are proposed. And both of the structures have Mills Act agreements in place, so any future maintenance or repairs that are needed would be in conformance with those agreements. A mitigated negative declaration was drafted for the hotel project, which did include an analysis of any impacts to cultural resources. An in-depth historical resources evaluation was prepared by a historic architect, and which they recommended mitigation measures in order to preserve the historic structures as a resource to the community and to ensure that the relocation is done properly. As such, the buildings would be documented in accordance with the Historic American Building Survey, the relocation plan would be submitted, and a historic architect would remain on site during the relocation. As you know, the role of the Historic Resources Commission is to issue a certificate of appropriateness for the exterior modifications in conformance with the Secretary of Interior standards, and staff does recommend approval of the certificate based on the plan review of the plans. And that concludes the staff report. Staff's available for any questions, and also the applicant is here if you have any questions of them.
Okay, thank you so much. Okay, does any commissioner have any questions of staff at this point?
Madam Chair, I have a question.
Okay, Commissioner Hardy.
Yes, I'm curious about the home on the north side of 2056 North Bush. The address 2058 North Bush. Is that going to be demolished? That property?
Yes.
It's not significant in any way?
It is not significant. That was part of the historic resources evaluation. It did have some fire damage and extensive alterations over time, so it's not eligible for listing.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Good question.
Question?
Sorry.
questions?
I have one question. Can we make it a condition that they add a plaque, a historical plaque to it that at least calls out that it's a historical designated home and the registry number and the type it is and the date it was built? That way you can track it. I know that you had concerns about the mural between the homes, kind of giving it that commercial. I think maybe the plaque, having the plaque out front, would bring back some of that historical significance.
I think that is a condition that would be appropriate to be considered by the HRC.
Thank you.
I have some questions. Okay. Looking at the modifications, okay, I can understand since the stairs are in the back of the house and everything, but you're replacing windows with other long windows that take care of that really doesn't configure with that style of a home, the historic home. You're putting in larger windows that is not part of the character of that house in order to make it like a door. So my question is, and then some of the others that you're taking out and moving, you know, other areas and parts of the building that really take away the character of the house, which we put it on our historic register as that house is, you know, historic significance to Santa Ana. So how can we give them approval to do this to an historic home, which is totally, you know, my view, you're re-altering, you know, what we approved to begin with.
So if I can interject for a moment. So one of the things we did with this project is that we engaged Chattel, who is our historic architect, and as required by CEQA, we needed a qualified historic architect to give input. And while those changes change that elevation, in their expertise and their experience, there is some give in the Secretary of Interior standards. So there's a lot of situations where you'll see that historic homes or structures might be altered so that they can be more usable, more functional. So I think on this particular project, it's the primary elevation that was most critical. And like on the one elevation that you can maybe pull up where the doors were being introduced. So in this case, what we worked with the applicant was to keep the frame of the window. Is this the one, Selena? Yeah. So where we keep the frame of the window, the original window, and then they use that as the door opening. So you have a story of the history of the building, but that it's being allowed to have some adjustment, some freedom for its new use. So once again, historic buildings, you know, they're allowed to have a couple of different lives and to evolve to different uses. And it's at the purview of the commission, of course, but traditionally, there is some leeway allowed, but when that does occur, we try and work, like we said before, is to keep the original window size so that at least there's a record of that history, if you will. And the one thing I would like to touch on, too, that I believe was in Selena's presentation is the once again, that front elevation that's visible from the street is there's been some dialogue to adjust the over here you'll see there's a mural with some glass above it. So one of the things in relocating a historic structure, particularly the residential one, is to try and keep that residential character and ambiance. So when you move it, you're still supposed to keep that setting, if you will. So we've been working with the applicant to actually take away the mural and transition that to a green wall, which would be more in keeping and complementary to a residential setting. So I wanted to bring up that point, make sure that you understood that.
And then in addition, keeping that on there, the trees, the bushes, the trees that are on there, and especially to the right, there you got two trees. What is one of the agreements is that it must be visible, that structure must be visible. Mm-hmm. It is blocking already the visibility of that, which really, you know, you can't do that to an historic home. So all of that landscaping is going to have to be adjusted. so it's visible from the street. We went through this all of last year, and for us to come in and see this kind of rendering, you know, for blockage, and as you know, the view corridor, it must have that in there, and what I'm seeing right now, you're going to be having it blocked. And that is totally against, especially Mills, that agreement.
So, Selena, could you respond to the conditions on the tree? The
trees,
existing conditions?
Several. Look at that. Okay. Okay, those are young. And just think in about a couple of years how it's going to be, going to obscure the structure. So, because you have to see, if that's a historic home, you have to see the character of that home. From the street and from the front level. And as you see, it's already a full tree there. You're blocking the roof. You're blocking the side of the house. You're blocking a lot of things that you do not see from the street, which is in total violation, especially of the Mills Act, of that historic property.
So, Chairman Christie, we could make that a condition as well, as we've had with a number of our projects that have come forward when it's identified that there's a tree or something, we work with the applicant to appropriately trim that back or design things differently so that the house...
I think, you know, you're moving the historic home, okay, into another area. You've got to protect that. You've got to protect it, and especially here on the commission, it is our charge to make sure that that structure is in compliance. So this is why, number one, I'm bringing these questions out here and now, so that whoever the applicant is, we take this very seriously. You know, you move that home, and you're going under a certificate as far as to preserving it, it has to be like for like.
Excuse me, Madam Chair, could I get up and take a look at that picture? Because my eyes aren't that good, uh-huh. And I can't really see it.
Go ahead.
And I have a question for the chair. Are you talking about the palm trees?
I'm talking about not only the larger the other trees you see over there.
The larger tree is behind the property, isn't it?
It's on the side.
The back side, isn't it?
It's the front side. Right. It's the front side.
Might I make a suggestion that the commission consider a condition that would require that the landscaping keep the view
to the Mills Act agreement, yes.
Right, that keeps the visibility of the historic structure, and you put that as a condition that could be monitored every 5 years or whatever would be your pleasure. This is the opportunity since you have this before you.
Can I ask a clarifying question about that then? Because all of our residential properties have trees, okay. And we're not talking about the primary elevation, we're talking about a secondary elevation, correct? Is where the tree is that you're concerned about?
Well,
primary just has a palm tree. I mean, you can see clearly around that, I think.
No, look at the other drawing for the restaurant. Go back.
Yes, that's the side elevation. That's my question to staff.
The primary elevation is what we should be focusing on.
Aren't we mostly concerned about the primary elevation?
Main Street's correct, yes.
So what we were looking at where the trees are...
That tree will be in the courtyard between the two buildings. Right. So it'll be a secondary elevation.
So the tree is not in front of the building. It's on the side of the building.
Side of the building. Oh, yes. Okay. Okay.
Which I think is different. The view corridor would be considered Main Street, correct?
Right. Correct.
Okay, I'm sorry. I thought this was Main Street as we were looking on. That's where I got confused on that. For that, because it looks like it's Main Street.
This elevation is Main Street,
yeah.
Yes. As shown for the Melton House. The McFarland House, sorry, I don't have both of them on the same plan. The large tree next to the McFarland House is on the north side of the house, which would be a secondary elevation. And that's an existing tree. It's been there for about 100 years, and we're trying to preserve it in place.
Because it looks like it's Main Street, you know, the way that you have it, and that's why I'm saying that's Main Street.
Right. And I would recommend a condition of approval that we add to review the landscape plans for any new palm trees.
Right.
Or any new trees.
Okay. Very good. Any other questions for staff? Okay, all right. Then at this time and place is the public hearing on item number one for the historic exterior modification application 2017-01 and historic exterior modification number 2017-02. Oh, I'm sorry, I already did that. Would the applicant like to come forth? I have a green card for JP. Are you the applicant?
No, I'm the applicant.
Oh,
I
okay. Okay.
PJ.
Thank you for allowing me to speak. Yeah. I'm the owner of these properties. My wife and I purchased these homes, the ones Milton property and the McFarland property, about 3.5 years ago. And when we purchased the property, we of course knew they were on the historic registry. We made immediately met with the city council and the historic Holly with the historic department, and also had the opportunity to meet with the McFarland family. We have documentations, photographs, and the family living there for the past 77 and a half years or so. And our commitment to the city, my wife and I, and to the McFarland family is to restore and maintain the property as its original condition and do the best we can. And we have done that as much as we can. I've hired historic period painters to give us colors for those periods and maintain it with a, you know, carpenters and so on and so forth. When we were approached to have a hotel built next to this project and incorporate our building, we were pleasantly surprised that the developer was harmoniously blending in the hotel with these historic homes. I have photographs of the older, from going back to 20, 30, 40, 50 years ago, where three generations of McFarland family lived there and did business at the end of their time. And that tree, there in question, it's been there over 100 years. It's been in every one of the photographs they provided for me. So I'm here to lend my support and my wife's support to the development. And it's basically the fact that he is appreciating and harmoniously blending in these beautiful homes and preserving it, continuing preserving it. And that's what I'm here for.
Okay.
Thank you for letting me speak.
Thank you. Mr. Applicant, your name, please.
My name is Mr. Applicant. I had to go with it. You fed it to me.
I know.
It was perfect. My name is Kevin Coleman. I am the applicant on this. I totally respect what you guys are here to do. I'm appreciative that someone takes the time to serve like this. Some of the issues that you brought up today, the addition of the doors was to alleviate the potential of having to put ADA ramps to destroy the visual of the house, which I feel sad when I see some of these beautiful homes in town that end up to be able to be used, have to have that big, long handicap ramp that just destroys the elevation. We placed the elevation for the handicap ramp in the aft of the building behind it so that the side entrances, which have the least amount of street visual look, is where we put the entries to the buildings. The tree that you spoke of is on the side of the property, and it was actually in the historical registry's recommendation to keep that tree, do everything we could to save that 100-year-old tree. To the extent that I've gone and even acquired a tree to go into the courtyard area that is blending with that tree, the same trunk and that look, so that I had some balance and weight to it. The trees you spoke of on Main Street, they actually are city trees. I don't control them. They've been there a lot longer than I have. So those are palm trees out in the public right of way. I have no intentions of putting any large shrubbery. I wanted to just have it be balanced, similar to what it is currently on Bush Street. And the landscaping on the McFarland house would stay as the same. So I've had the pleasure of working with these houses. I'm kind of excited about having them there and making them stay part of our city and blend and work with our new hotel that'll be on the site. And I'd gladly answer any questions that you may have. And Michael, it was nice to see you again.
Good to see you.
Yes. We have a property that we both worked at.
Should I recuse myself because of that?
No. I've known him before.
We're acquaintances, yeah, neighbors.
Well, I have to yield to Ryan.
I mean, this is the first I'm hearing of the issue, but I mean, you tell me if this decision would in any way provide any sort of economic benefit. So, yeah, I don't think it would. Then I think you'd be fine.
No. Okay. I don't like that guy.
Good call. Smart move, Mike.
And the idea of the plaques, what's your thoughts on that?
Doesn't bother me at all. The one issue about, I did want to bring up, I'm glad you asked about the plaques. Plaques doesn't bother me. The art wall that I had intended in there, I have worked with the Bowers Museum to look at creating an actual mural starting with the beginning of our city, carrying it through, and on the right, let's see, it would be the south side of the mural, I wanted to put the infinity symbol with an arrow kind of indicating that our city's going to go on forever. So that was part of that, because as you know, that street has the queuing of the freeway every day. So I felt that, and it was suggestions from folks here in the city that kind of guided me on my art program, that would be something that the city could look at every day as they sit there on Main Street waiting to queue onto the freeway. And I wanted it to be representative of our city, literally from the start, which we're using all the historical photos inside our hotel also. I've gotten special permission from Hilton to utilize our water tower, our Main Street sign, things that when people step off the elevator, they can go, wait, I saw that. And they could literally look out the window and see the water tower. I wanted to try to tie our city back into my lobby and the entire hotel. And then the hotel feeds right into these two historical homes, so people know. So I wouldn't mind putting that plaque there. I think it would be awesome to, especially I knew the McFarlands. I did business with the McFarlands for years. I think it would be honorable to let them be cherished for what they kept our city and let us have.
One of the reasons I like the idea of the plaques is a lot of times these days they try to make restaurants look old. Bringing in all kinds of antique stuff and everything else.
Yes.
Well, here you really have a
real
vintage home. And so as people walk in, they would see that plaque and they would go, now here's the story of what this structure was about.
I've done a couple of other historical properties, and I actually utilized in one of our lobbies, we utilized all of the historical photographs when that was the only building on the street. And it was a dirt road, and now it's a six-lane Irvine Boulevard. So I have done them, and I do like, I think that gives, especially like if you're in a waiting area of a restaurant, you're reading it, and you go, oh, wow, this is the history of our town. That's important to me. It adds character to the building. It adds character to everything we're trying to do here.
Exactly. Thank you.
Is that appropriate?
Going to include photographs inside the Is it a restaurant?
The hotel.
In the hotel, I have
and
them.
What about inside the house itself?
We have not designed the interiors as yet, so I would look to do that. We're keeping the rooms. There's a beautiful set of 100-year-old sliding pocket doors that roll better than the ones in my home right now. So it's like there's some really cool elements that I think we could go ahead and use as a statement for when like a guest is sitting in what used to be the McFarland dining room and actually have photographs of the family, because PJ was fortunate enough to get some of that type of historical photos from the family. Put that stuff on so people see that this was really somebody's home before they made it their business place and moved upstairs and lived upstairs and stayed downstairs with the business. So I think it would be cool to put that in there, and I'd gladly do that.
Great.
Madam Chair, is it appropriate for me to make comments at this time regarding the issue? Or?
Well, it's the applicant, so therefore you can have the...
I would just mention that I got my packet last night. I just got on this commission today, although I'd been on it before. And I was looking through the packet, and I was looking at your plans and all the information on it. I was very excited. I think it's really great. I think you're doing really a great thing.
I sincerely appreciate that. I've been at this for 2 years now, from the time the city asked me to go on a bus tour and buy a piece of real estate from the city, 2 years to get to this level, and I am excited about making this happen. And the community, the Bowers Museum, my neighbors, that have a historical property south of us, they're all saying the same thing. It's going to be a benefit to the community and to serve and take that north end of the Main Street and really update it and make it cool. So, any others?
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much for allowing me to speak.
Okay. Madam Secretary, do we have any written communications?
We do not.
Okay, and so forth. Is there anyone else that wants to speak on this subject? Okay, if not, declare the public hearing closed and bring it back to the council for discussion. No discussion?
I have a couple comments. I'd just like to say, as someone who has an architectural degree and loves old homes, I think this is a great project. It's an adaptive reuse. It gives the public an opportunity to get up close to some historic structures. I love the idea of putting a plaque on each of the houses. And maybe those could even, I don't know what's appropriate, by the front door facing that courtyard outdoor dining area. But it gives people a chance to sit under a 100-year-old tree, to admire the beauty of those homes. I would speak in favor of the public art wall versus a green hedge. I know green hedge is more residential, but this is not really a residential location being on Main. It is right across from Bowers Museum, so I think that's very appropriate. I'm glad to know that you're working with them on the design of it. It's gotta be good if they're involved. And people do queue up there to get on the freeway, so it gives them something interesting to look at in a positive way. And this has nothing to do with the historic structures, but I love that you're putting photos of old Santa Ana into the brand new building. So you're sort of tying the old to the new, and I think that's really unique and great. I will say one more thing. I was just up in Monterey on a business meeting for a board meeting, and we had a dinner one night, and the dinner was in an old home that had been converted to a restaurant. And you walk through a little courtyard, and there are all these little rooms inside, sort of similar to the cottage in Laguna Beach, if anyone had ever eaten there. Now it's Earth Cafe, and it feels very different to me. But anyway, it was very intimate and special, and you've got things, details like the wood moldings and the pocket doors and things like that. So it just makes it like you're eating in somebody's home. And I'm excited to go have a dinner with my wife at this location. I think it'll be great. It's a nice addition to the north end of town, so I'm in favor of it. I think it's great. Oh, and I want to say one more thing. The stairway that's on the north elevation of the McFadden property now really blocks that view more than the tree, in my opinion. So I'm glad the stairway is coming out, and the fact that we're putting a French door in where a window is, I think it's okay. And thank you.
Any other? Okay. Is there a recommendation from the commission? Commissioner Rushing?
I make the motion that we adopt a resolution approving a certificate of appropriateness for the historic exterior modification application number 2017-01. And also adopt a resolution approving a certificate of appropriateness for historic exterior modification application number 2017-02.
Okay, is there?
Can I also make a clarification on that? I know there's some discussion about adding a condition regarding the plaque. Would you like to add that to the motion as well?
I would like to add to both of those motions that we add the idea of a plaque, and also that the exterior shrubbage is in compliance with the Mills Act as far as the view corridor.
Is there a second?
I'll second that.
Okay. Moved by Commissioner Reschke. Second by Commissioner Tarav. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
All those opposed? Motion passed 6-0 with the absences of Commissioner Rush and Nguyen. Congratulations. Thank you. Next.
I will look forward to all of you dining there. No problem.
Invite us to the grand opening.
I will.
Now is the time and place for the public hearing on item number 2 for Historic Resource Commission application 2017-30, Historic Register Categorization number 2017-29 and Historic Property Preservation Agreement 2017-34 for the property located at 2008 North Heliotrope Drive. Staff will now do a presentation.
I will be presenting on behalf of Ivan Flores, who's a case planner on the project, as he's out of town. So just to start at the beginning, we have four applications tonight to be placed on the list and given the opportunity to have a Mills Act agreement. And those four addresses are before you on Heliotrope, Lacey, Greenleaf, and Flower. Once again, we'll just recap that there's two categories of listing that are proposed tonight. One of them is a contributive structure, and as a reminder, those are buildings that contribute to the overall character and history of a neighborhood and are a good example of period architecture. In addition, there's the key category, which has distinctive architectural style, or associated with a significant person or event within the city. So the one I'll be presenting at this point is the property at 2008 North Heliotrope Drive. It's being suggested that it be named the Gabriel House after the first owner that resided there. The architectural style is Colonial Revival, Cape Cod variant. The house was constructed in 1948 and is being proposed to be listed as contributive. So some of the highlights for the house are that, of course, it's a single-story residence, and has a strong horizontal massing that also suggests it has a bit of the ranch-style influence. The exterior of the house is clad in wide horizontal wood siding. It has a medium-pitched side gable roof with modest eaves. And it has two chimneys, one which appears to be original, the other one is a little more modernized, but still in keeping with the house. And in keeping with Cape Cod design, it contains a central entry that's flanked on either side by two large 8x8 double-hung windows, also adorned with shutters. And the entry is recessed between two slender pilasters and some side lights. So the other point of interest from a historical standpoint is that the house was built by developer Allison Honer for the amount of $25,000 for Melody Gabriel. And Melody and some of her family lived there till at least 1962, were owners in a company called Diamond Ice Company. And as I mentioned, they were there till approximately 1962 until Mrs. Herbert Miller shows to be recorded to have lived there in 1979. So those are some of the overall comments. The one thing I'll mention as well, the fence that's in the picture here, we'll be working with the applicant to get a front yard fence permit and make sure that the front yard fence is in keeping with our city standards. So with that in mind, we suggest that we recommend that the commission approve the two actions to place the structure on the list as contributive and recommend City Council authorize a Mills Act agreement. The applicant is here as well.
Thank you so much. Okay. Does the commissioner have any comments of staff at this time? No? Okay. The applicant, okay, is here. And I'm going to do this, okay? Okay. The applicants are Anthony and Maureen Lucas Zeski.
Close, but not... Lukashevsky. There you go.
Lukashevsky.
Okay.
Would you like to speak at this time?
You know, I don't have much to offer. You did both of
I don't have much to add to that because I learned about the house actually listening to you. But I will say that I had no intention of moving to Santa Ana. I came here to be near my grandchildren up in San Francisco Bay Area, and they live in Anaheim Hills. But I kind of fell in love with this house and the historical neighborhood, and so they have to drive to see me now. So I'm really excited about being here. It's a very unique neighborhood of sort of like-minded people who really appreciate preserving these older homes. So I don't know what else I could add. You guys know more than me. But I love, I pulled up articles about Honer and looked at little videos and stuff, and it's kind of exciting. Anyway, that's all I have to offer.
Thank you. Sure. We love to hear the stories of our residents, you know, that come in and buy these historical homes. Like, how did you hear about us, and why did you select, you know, Santa Ana?
You know, I got tired of looking at tract houses, and I Googled. I thought, this is ridiculous. There's got to be, you know, because we're just not familiar with the area. There has to be neighborhoods. There's got to be, because I lived in an older home up north. And I Googled vintage homes, Orange County, and Floral Park Home and Garden Tour came up. So I sent my kids over to look, and anyway, the rest is history.
Thank you so much.
Sure.
Welcome to Santa Ana. We appreciate
it. I'm happy to be here. I really am excited to be here. Thank you.
You're welcome. Thank you. Okay. is there anyone else that would love to speak on this application? Madam Secretary, do we have any communication?
We do not.
Okay. Okay, the public hearing is now closed. I'm going to bring it back to the commission. And do any of the commissioners have comments or a motion?
You know I have comments always. So first of all, I want to just point out a couple things. Honer was the developer or builder of this home, and we know he started Floral Park. It was his like dream to build a upscale kind of neighborhood. But I do want to point out that in 1948, when this house was built, $25,000 was a lot of money for a house. My parents built their house in 1960. And I think they spent about that much money. And so that was, you know, a long time before that, economically speaking. This house was also built with an original three-car garage. So that tells you something about the means of the original owner, right? That they wanted this to be a really special, impressive kind of property. And it is when you're there, when you're in it, when you're in front of it from the street. The prior owners did extensive renovation on the house. Maureen's had to undo one of their renovations. It was on the back of the house, done illegally. But I'm really happy to see her here and see the property going on the registry. I think it's one that we should be preserving because it's one of the prettiest houses on Heliotrope, in my opinion. And I don't know if there are other comments, but I'd love to move. This.
I have a comment. When Commissioner Reschke and I visit your home. I'm sorry you two were not there. We would love to have met you. We automatically Cape Cod. It is gorgeous, absolutely well maintained. Love your succulents. That's all there. That would have that coast, you know, like next to the seashore that you have with Cape Cod to represent that kind of landscaping that you would find there. And it's just a gorgeous, gorgeous home. And it is truly reflective. I mean, if you never knew what a Cape Cod house, we've taken, this is it. This is the standard for a Cape Cod house. But it is well kept, and like I said, welcome to Santa Ana. Beautiful. Okay.
So I'd like to make the motion on this one, and I'd like to move that we adopt a resolution approving the Historic Resources Commission application number 2017-30 and approving a Historic Register categorization 2017-29, and also that we recommend to the City Council and the City Manager and the Clerk of the Council to execute a Historic Property Preservation Agreement, a Mills Act, number 2017-34 with Anthony and Maureen, and I'm going to say this wrong, even though I should know how to say it.
Gaszewski.
Lukaszewski. Yeah, Lukaszewski, I think.
Is that closer?
It. So, and I so move.
Moved by Commissioner Schaefer. Is there a second?
Wasn't there a condition for the front yard fence?
For the.
The city will work that out, I think, with them.
The fence is actually a code requirement, so there's no reason to put a condition on it. They have to meet our code, so.
Right.
You're fine.
All right, thank you.
Is there a second? Seconded by Commissioner Hinderdale. All those in favor say aye.
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 All those opposed? Motion passed 6-0 with the absence of Commissioner Nguyen and Rush. Thank you so much. Welcome to the historic. Okay, moving on. Now is the time and place for the public hearing, opening of the public hearing to item number 3 for Historic Resource Commission application number 2017-63.
I'd like to introduce for a moment when you're ready. We'd like to introduce Pedro Gomez as the case planner. I'm not sure if you met him in earlier sessions, but he's new to our staff. He's an assistant planner one, and he's got some architecture background, so we're really glad to have him, and he'll be presenting the next few projects.
Okay, thank you. Okay.
Sorry to interrupt.
All right, let me start over again. Okay, now this is the time and place for the public hearing, item number 3, and the opening of the public hearing on the Historic Resource Commission application number 2017-63, Historic Register Categorization number 2017-62. The parrots are here. And Historic Property Preservation Agreement numbers 2017-65 for the property located at 918 North Lacey Street. Staff will now make the presentation.
Good evening, Madam Chair and Commissioners. It's a pleasure to be presenting to you for the first time. The second case for your consideration is being called the Taylor Rose House. It's located at 918 North Lacey Street within the French Park neighborhood. It's a two-story craftsman bungalow constructed in 1914 and designed by notable architect Frederick Ely. It's recommended that the property be listed on the register and categorized as key for its distinctive architectural style and quality, for its association with a significant period in the history of the city, and for its association with a significant person. Specifically, the Taylor Rose House is historically significant for its contribution to the French Park National Register Historic District, and architecturally significant for its association with Frederick Ely, as mentioned. It's a good example of Ely's work in the craftsman style, with its low-pitched side gable roof treatment, strongly horizontal lines, and use of wood reminiscent of Swiss and Japanese architectural traditions. Ely is known as Santa Ana's premier historic architect, and having built a substantial portfolio of architectural commissions throughout Orange County that includes several schools, residences, and a variety of commercial and institutional buildings. Although this property was designed by Frederick Ely, the Taylor Rose House was built by the original owners, John and Minnie Taylor. John was a dry goods business owner, and Minnie was a John was in the dry goods business in downtown Santa Ana, A year later, William and Emma Rose purchased the house, therefore the name Taylor Rose. Miss Rose was a miller for Orange County, Mr. Rose was a miller for Orange County Mills. And after Mr. Rose's passing in the late 1920s, Miss Rose continued to live in the house for several years. So within the first couple of years, two owners lived in the house. Some of the character-defining features of the Taylor Rose House include the low-pitched side-facing gabled roof and the wide eaves, the exposed structural elements such as the beams and rafter tails, the triangular knee braces, the vertical boards with vertical cutouts, the wood shingles covering the second floor, the ribbons of the casement windows, the 6-over-1 double-hung windows, the single-storied porch featuring pairs of exposed beams and wide eaves, and lastly, the south bay window. Given its exemplification of the distinguishing characteristics of the craftsman bungalow style, its contribution to the French Park neighborhood, and the fact that it was designed by Frederick Ely, staff recommends that the commission place the property as key and enter into a Meals Act agreement with the applicant. That concludes the presentation. I'd be happy to answer questions at this time.
I just have one question.
Sure.
How many two-story Craftsman bungalows do we have in Santa Ana? That's why I'm asking the question. It's the first one that I've seen. It's rare, isn't it, that we have? I think I was asking Commissioner Schaefer, I said, two-story Craftsman bungalow? You know, because normally it's this way, and he says the Greenleaf?
The Green and Green house in Pasadena, the Gamble house, is designed by Green and Green, is obviously two-story, and there are many two-story Craftsman bungalows in that area.
But... not like this. So we have a rare home here because this is the first time I've seen this style in our city. So this is truly a gem. Okay? That was my question. Anybody else have questions of staff? No? Okay. Moving on. Thank you so much. Now we'll move on. Is the applicant here?
Yes.
Hi, Tabitha, come on up. Welcome.
Thank you. I'm Tabitha Hunter. That's my home. And this may be weird, but I dispute some of the history. If you don't mind me taking a second. In 1890, the Spurgeons, Jenny and William, purchased the whole Block 84. Then in 1909, they incorporated into the W.H. Spurgeon Realty Company, and that property was incorporated. In 1911, Frederick Ely moved to town. In 1911 also, Sarah Bloodgood purchased the home, but not the home, purchased the lots, 25 and 26 from the Spurgeon Realty Company. May, she got a permit to build, and the builders were Remsburg and Mitchell, and it was $3,000 to build the house. By December, it was done. And the only reason I know that the house was completed was because she was listing rooms to rent in a brand new building on 918 North F Street at that time. That's what threw me off in my research, was that was F Street back at that time. So then once I figured that out, it all kind of came together. She died very shortly after that in 1912, and I know she was sick for a year. So whether she actually lived in the house, she'd never been married. Whether she actually lived in the house those 6 months, she was dying, so she may have never lived there herself. So after that, the estate the executor was her brother. There was a dispute between the heirs, and the court ruled that the Bloodgood estate needed to be sold. So it was sold May of 14 to Mrs. Rose, who lived there for 40 plus years after that. December 14, it was renamed to Lacey Street. So I don't know who the Taylors are. I could not find any reference to the Taylors, and I know that the home wasn't built in 1914. It was built in 1911.
Thank you for that great insight and research.
Yes.
So Commissioner Rushkin and I spoke to Tabitha and her husband, Jocelyn, and she was telling us all that, and I said, well, that makes sense. How can it be 1910,
I think, is where it's listed somewhere.
And the guy didn't show up until 11? That didn't...
So we welcome that kind of additional research. And the 1914, if I'm correct, actually came from the survey in the National Register. So whoever did the research back then.
Bought the residence from Bloodgood.
Yeah. So what I would offer is that staff can go back and work with yourself and augment that portion of the history so it's as thorough and complete as possible. And the Taylor name actually, too, was, I believe, part of the National Register. So we'll have to go back and see where that Taylor came from, but the Rose Taylor name of the house came from when it was put on the National Register.
After I saw that you guys were calling it Rose Taylor, I went back and I did all the research again trying to find any reference to Taylor, and I could not. I could not connect the lots, the block, F, Lacey, anything with anybody named Taylor.
So you said the house was built in 1911?
1911.
Yeah. And Mr. Taylor didn't come into town until 1913.
Oh,
so that makes perfect sense.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
That came in there. That's why we love to have our residents in Wally's homes, because of the fact that you're giving us more information than we can correct our historical records. So thank you for putting all of that due diligence in.
Well, I love the name Rose, of course. She lived there 40 years. It was her home. I would say Rose House.
It's a beautiful home. It really is a beautiful home. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. Is there anyone else that wishes to speak on this item? If not, I'll declare the public hearing closed and bring it back to the commissioners for comments or in motion.
I'm going to make a comment about the name. I would recommend maybe once the research supports us, that we just call it the Rose House. If she was there for 40 years, obviously was the longest occupant of the property, and unless we can find out who Taylor, it sounds like we know some information about Taylor, because you're going to share that next, right?
Right.
Okay, I'll shut up.
So I was curious. I looked up to see who John Taylor was, and he was a well-known in the city, as he was engaged in the mercantile trade, operating three stores at one time. He came to Santa Ana in 1913, retired in 1932, and passed away November 13th, 1942. So, and he was survived by his wife, Minnie, and all that information. So that does correlate, but I can't find his association with that property. But here is a picture of Mr. Taylor. I'll share with you.
Very good.
So we can definitely double back and do the research, and we'll have to look back. You know, as I said, it's listed on the National Register inventory with the Taylor name, so we can go back and see what information they were pulling from that they felt that both names were included.
It sounds unlikely if Rose bought it before 1913 and he came to town in 1913. So unless he would have bought it after Rose.
We'll do the due diligence, and then based on your recommendation, it can revert back to just the one name if we're not finding substantive information on Mr. Taylor.
Okay. I would also recommend that Tabitha had a wonderful book about the builder. If you don't have a copy of that, I suggest you get a copy for our library.
Very good. Very good.
Interesting. I'd like to move approval of this item. That we adopt a resolution approving the Historic Resources Commission application number 2017-63 and approving Historic Register categorization number 2017-62, and that we recommend to the City Council to authorize the City Clerk and the City Manager to execute a Historic Property Preservation Agreement number 2017-65, a Mills Act agreement with Jason and Tabitha Hunter.
Is there a second?
I second the motion. Okay.
Moved by Commissioner Schaefer, second by Commissioner Rushby. All those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Motion passed 6-0 with Commissioner Nguyen and Rush absent. Congratulations, Tabitha. Welcome. Now, this is the time and place for the public hearing on item number 4, which we're opening, for the Historic Resource Commission application number 2017-31, Historic Register categorization number 2017-30, and Historic Property Preservation Agreement 2017-35 for the property located 2140 Greenleaf Street. Staff will now make the presentation.
Thank you, Madam Chair. This next case for your consideration is being referred to as the Heath House, located on 2140 North Greenleaf, within the Floral Park neighborhood. The Heath House is a Tudor revival constructed in 1929. It is recommended that the property be listed on the register and categorized as contributive, as a good example of period architecture, and because it contributes to the overall character and history of Floral Park. This one-story residence is a highly characteristic example of a modestly sized Tudor revival home from the late 1920s. The architect and builder are unknown. However, the first known residents were J.O. Heath and Miss Heath. The Heath House incorporates a steeply pitched cross-gabled roof that tops the stucco-covered building and incorporates a side gable that spans the building and the two front gables. The once wood-shingled roof includes a rolled edge with little or no overhangs. The smaller of the front gables tops a centered entry vestibule accessed by two arched openings, each of which is outlined by stone coins. A round-headed wooden front door opens off the vestibule. Stone coins also decorate two large rounded tripart windows located to either side of the extended entry. The north window is centered beneath the larger front gable, whose extended north rank tops an arched opening in a wing wall. Diamond-shaped attic vents are located to the ends of the large front and side gables. And lastly, the driveway leads to a detached one-story stucco-clad front-gabled garage built in the same time as the residence and also detailed with the diamond-shaped vents. Some of the character-defining features include the materials and finishes, the steeply pitched roof, the stone coin accents, the arch entry, the asymmetrical arrangements of the building features, the tall brick chimney, the picturesque windows, the diamond pattern vents, and the cross-gabled massing. Given its exemplification of the distinguishing characters of the Tudor Revival style and its contribution to the Floral Park neighborhood, staff recommends that the commission designate the property as contributive and enter into a Mills Act agreement with the applicant. That concludes staff's report for this case. I'd be happy to answer questions at this time.
Does any of the commissioners have any questions of staff? No? Moving on. Is the applicant here?
Madam Chair, I did want to let you know that the applicant reached out and said she would not be able to make it to tonight's hearing.
Oh, okay. Thank you so much. Okay. Madam Secretary, do we have any written communications?
We do not.
Okay. If not, I now declare the public hearing closed and bring it back to the commission for any comments or action.
Madam Chairman, I would like to make the motion that we adopt a resolution approving Historic Resource Commission application number 2017-31 and approving Historic Register categorization number 2017-30. I also recommend that the City Council authorize the City Manager and the Clerk of the Council to execute a Historic Property Preservation Agreement number 2017-35. Mills Act Agreement with Daniel and Stephanie Schaefer, subject to non-substantive changes approved by the City Manager and City Attorney.
Is there a second?
Second.
Okay. Moved by Commissioner Rushke and second by Commissioner Schaefer. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
All those opposed? Motion passed 6-0 with Commissioners Nguyen and Rush absent. Well, let's give them a hand for being on our register. Okay. Next, we're now is the time and place, the opening of the public hearing on item number 5 for the Historic Resource Commission application number 2017-64, Historic Register Categorization number 2017-63, and Historic Property Preservation number 2017-66 for the property located at 2140 North Flower Street. And staff?
And Madam Chair, I swear this one's the last one for me tonight. This last case for your consideration is known as the Butler House, and it's also located within the Floral Park neighborhood at 2140 North Flower. The Butler House is a ranch house constructed in 1938. It is recommended that the property be listed on the register and categorized as contributive as a good example of period architecture and because it contributes to the overall character and history of Floral Park. This one-story single-family residence is on a large parcel sited with a deep front yard setback. A detached garage is located at a few feet behind the north end of the rear elevation. The garage and the house delineate a reversed L-shape plan, which provides a generous-sized patio. Asymmetrical in design, the house exhibits a strong horizontal emphasis expressed through a low-pitched Dutch gabled roof with wide overhanging enclosed eaves. The exterior of the house is clad in a combination of brick, smooth stucco, and horizontal wood, while board and batten inside the garage. The roof treatment defines three sections of the front east facade. In the middle, the entry porch is characterized by brick cladding around the door and below a large tripart, metal-framed casement window. Lacy New Orleans style wrought iron posts support the porch roof overhang. Lastly, metal frame casement windows also appear in the north and south sections of the facade along with a porthole window. The first known residents were Merton David Butler and Tessie Childers. M.D. Butler was a successful businessman, well known as a hatchery man and a leader in the poultry industry. Tessie Butler taught junior high school for several years in Santa Ana. According to city directories, the next resident was Forrest E. Ellis, who resided at the property for an unknown period of time. Again, given this property's exemplification of the distinguishing characters of the ranch style and its contribution to Floral Park neighborhood, staff recommends that the commission designate the property as contributive and enter into a Mills Act agreement with the applicant. That concludes this presentation. I'd be happy to answer questions at this time.
Thank you so much. Does any commissioner have any questions of our staff? No? Okay. Thank you. Okay. Would the applicant? There. Yes. Is it
Jean Pietro? Yes.
Okay.
Jean Pietro.
Thank you.
Yeah, I actually moved here from Rhode Island originally, and in college I worked on historic properties, and so it was actually always really something important to me to own an older home. And so when I came to California, I lived in Newport, Costa Mesa, and then I really had a strong desire to have an older home, so I went looking in all the different areas, and I had a friend say, "Have you checked Floral Park?" And I said, "I've never even heard of Floral Park." So I finally found it, and then I started driving around and looked for something, you know. And so when I found this house, although it was somewhat a little bit beat up, when the real estate agent opened the door, I just kind of fell in love with it, because it's a really strong old house that has, you know, really thick redwood, and so it's just a great old house. And so I've really enjoyed living there, and the history is that I guess the gentleman, Butler, did live there for a while, and he basically had chickens running around, but they had hatcheries all over the West Coast, and he was like president of the Turkey Federation, and brought a lot of the actual poultry industry to Orange County. So so he's considered one of like the who's who in Orange County. So he was did a lot for, you know, for the area. And the house, very little was done to it for a long, long time. And was kind of in my labor of love, and I've been working on it for about 7 years now. So, and I live across the street from Ed, so he can tell you that I do work on it. And did you have any questions or?
No. No, what college did you go
in? I went to Rhode Island College.
Rhode Island?
Yeah, so we had relationship with Providence Preservation, and back, you know, in Rhode Island, there's a lot of actually colonial homes, mm-hmm. so a lot of older homes, and it's really important in Rhode Island to maintain those older homes. They're really, really, you know, well regarded and well thought of. They would never think to tear those down. So it's really unique to have a neighborhood like that, this in California, because a lot of the neighborhoods to me are very, very new, and you see older communities and they just get kind of torn down. So Floral Park to me is a wonderful neighborhood, and I didn't think that I would find something like this in Southern California, so I'm really glad I stumbled upon it after looking for, you know, a great neighborhood. And we have, you know, a wonderful neighborhood, wonderful neighbors, and everyone's really, I think, committed to being part of an older community and keeping, you know, these homes intact. and enjoying them, and knowing that, you know, people tell me, you'll never be done, you'll never be finished. So don't even think about being finished, because you'll never be finished. But because they are, you know, more maintenance, but like, they are a labor of love, and once you get into one, you get kind of hooked, so a little bit addicted to it. So
I'm so glad you left the cold weather.
Yes.
My granddaughter is at Johnson Wales.
Oh, okay.
In Providence.
Yeah, it's a wonderful school, yeah.
And she's called, I'm freezing.
Yes.
I'm freezing.
Yes.
But anyway, so yes. Welcome to the site.
Thank you.
Comment for the applicant is okay. Just, I was in the house when it was for sale, and it was so neglected and run down, and just like nobody had loved it for a long time.
Yes.
So thank you for
yes.
your labor of love and working to restore it.
Yes.
It's yeah, appreciated it's, and noticed.
It's wonderful to look at the, you know, before pictures, because I'm sure if you saw it before, you know, it was rather beat up. So, but it's moving, we're moving along, and it's coming along. So any other questions?
Or? Thank you so
thank
much
you.
For your
thank
information.
You.
Wow. Does anyone else like to speak on this property? If not, Madam Secretary, do we have it written?
We have not.
Okay, moving on. Public hearing is now closed. I'm going to bring it back to the commissioners for comments or motion.
I would like to make a comment. One of my favorite things is to research these homes, and I love to go back and read.
Commissioner Marusha, is this the property that you'll be abstaining yourself
yes,
from?
Yes, it is.
Unfortunately, if you're abstaining, then you're not supposed
okay.
to make any comments.
I understand.
Regarding. Thank you.
My only comment is that from 1938, this is a very original ranch-style home. It was really a trendsetter and way before its time, because more in the 50s and 60s, and you know, that's when the ranchers really became popular. So this is a kind of a cool house, and it's got the porthole window and some really unique things that tie it more to the 30s, I think, with a streamlined modern. It's a little bit of a mix-up. With those two, so it's a great property.
Any other comments?
No.
Okay. Is there a motion?
I'd like to make a motion.
Commissioner Hardy.
I'd like to make a motion to adopt a resolution approving Historic Resources Commission application number 2017-31 and approving Historic Register categorization number 2017-30, and recommend that the City Council authorize the City Manager and Clerk of the Council to execute a Historic Property Preservation Agreement number 2017-35 Mills Act Agreement.
Is there a second?
I'll second.
Okay. Moved by Commissioner Hardy, second by Commissioner Tarab. All those in favor say aye.
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 All those opposed, abstention. We have one with Commissioner Reschke. If motion carries, 5-1 abstention, and the absence of Commissioner Rush and Wynn. Congratulations. Welcome to our register. Okay. Now we're moving to our next item on the agenda. Administrative matters. The first item is to discuss opposition to 2525 North Main Street project. And I have a speaker request on the, wrong color, on item number 6 from Dale. Dale Helvick?
Helvick, yes. Correct.
Oh, great. Thank you. Okay.
Good evening, Madam Chairman and the rest of the commissioners. My name's Dale Helvick. I live in the Park Santiago neighborhood, have for the last 27-plus years. House built in 1936. Love the neighborhood. Love the mix of it. What I'm here to talk about is back in November of last year, a developer came forward and presented a project for a 517-unit apartment complex essentially at the entrance to Park Santiago neighborhood. It's right across the street from a circa 1900 home, which I believe is part of the historical homes that are on the listing for Santa Ana. The project itself is totally incompatible with the neighborhood. The development would be great over in the section of Chapman and State College, where they're building all those five-story high-rises that have that modernistic look to it, down in Irvine, down in the legacy area of Tustin. It's not a project that fits in North Santa Ana. Our neighborhood association formed a committee, which I'm chairman of, the North Santa Ana Preservation Alliance, and our purpose is to maintain the integrity and the historical significance of North Santa Ana. We believe that this project is totally out of character for North Santa Ana. We like the idea of the Hampton Inn project taking care of the couple historical homes there. We're going to flip it over and do the exact opposite if this project goes through. I think it's a shame if it even gets approved. And so I applaud you guys for taking it up as an issue and looking at voicing your objections to it as well. So thank you.
Thank you. Is there anyone else that would like to speak to this matter? If not, okay. Staff, you're up. How do we do this?
So this item is on the agenda at the request of the commission. Go ahead.
Do you want your comments first and then the commission comments?
City staff doesn't really have any comments. So I think the expectation was this was a discussion that the commission wanted to have time to voice their thoughts on this, and that the commission had expressed an interest to share those comments and translate them into a resolution to forward to council. And I think we'll have our city attorney, though, just frame the discussion a little bit as far as.
Okay.
Right. Thank you. Yes, and just to, you know, I don't know, I wasn't here when the request was put in, but just taking a look at the heading in the agenda, I just kind of want to address the commission's powers and duties when it comes to actions like this. The municipal code lays out in 2-374 the powers and duties of this board. And under subsection E, it does talk about the power of the Historic Resources Commission to recommend to City Council policies and regulations regarding the protection, reuse, and rehabilitation of historical property. So it appears that there would be some nexus to that power and duty to this discussion. However, I do want to just make it clear for the record that this particular property, 2525 North Main, and the proposed project is not a historical property and is not within the jurisdiction of the Historical Resources Commission. So that the specifics to that project will not come before this board. And so this discussion shouldn't necessarily focus on the specifics of that project, but should focus more on, as the power and duty state, the protection of the historical properties or that the nearby adjacent area, the adjacent area there.
The adjacent area. Thank you.
Thank
okay.
You.
Back to the commission.
Okay. Yeah, I'll start. I'm sure other people have comments as well. I think the project is inappropriate next to a historic neighborhood. At our last meeting, we put a house on that would be literally two doors away from this 5 to 8 story building, and that would be abutting into the backyard of all of the residents along Spurgeon Street and cast a shadow probably over to French the next block over. So it's just the massing right next to single family homes is what I'm opposed to. I think it's Park Santiago is a beautiful neighborhood, like our speaker said, of vintage custom homes that are built anywhere from the turn of the century up to the late 50s, and there's a tremendous amount of architectural variety from Victorian to ranch style and everything in between. So it just is a bad juxtaposition to have that kind of project immediately adjacent to those residences. I think it's very poor design, in my opinion. I'm not opposed to the property being developed and doing something there, but I think there's a better way to do a project at that location.
Okay. I'd like to identify my remarks with Commissioner Schaefer. I feel exactly the same way. And if the resolution could be worded along the lines of what you just stated, I think that would be good to consider.
Okay, Commissioner Hiddell?
Yes, I wanted to clarify the recommended actions to direct staff to prepare a resolution to be considered by the commission at the next regularly scheduled meeting. Am I to understand that the resolution could not refer specifically to this address or this property? We could have a resolution that would discuss in general terms what we consider appropriate or the impact on an historical structure of some adjacent development.
Right. I mean, within the powers and duties of the commission, I think it's more appropriate to discuss how or what measures could be taken to protect the historical structures rather than focusing on the non-historical project that is being considered. So if there's some options or considerations that you think would, you know, could help to protect the historical structure, I think that should be the focus.
Commissioner Rush?
I just have to think, when I think in terms of like Floral Park, for example, 19th Street has some beautiful historic homes. Right across the street is the office buildings and everything else. So those have kind of fallen in disfavor and dilapidated because people don't take care of them because they're right next to that industrial area. I wonder if this would happen the same thing in Park Santiago.
Well, I would also like to discover or find some ways that we could insulate Park Santiago from this new development. Exactly what those ways are, I think it would take maybe a little time, but I do also agree with the other comments that the other commissioners have said, and perhaps that's where the answer lies.
I think that there will be an impact to the neighborhood. There's, you know, you don't have to be a brain surgeon to figure this out. When they have less than two parking spots per unit that's proposed, those people are going to park in that neighborhood. There's going to be extra traffic there. It will degrade that neighborhood. Now, it is not an official historic neighborhood district or something like French Park is, but to turn our heads, turn a blind eye to the fact that this is one of the beautiful neighborhoods that we have in Santa Ana that's intact and in very good condition with very few inappropriate remodeled homes. I mean, it's very, very consistent. And to think that we would do something that would have a negative impact to a neighborhood like that is very disappointing to me, having served on this commission for 15 plus years. So I would hope that we would have some type of input into the appropriateness of what's put there, that it would minimize, I don't know how to word this, maybe you can help, Brian, that's your expertise, but to minimize the impact of this project to that neighborhood. And what the solution is, I'm not proposing that right now, but there needs to be something that's sympathetic to the neighborhood.
I certainly understand and appreciate your concerns, and just to let you know that, you know, this is the type of project that, you know, the entitlements will go to the Planning Commission, I believe. You know, there will be certain matters or certain items that they will need to obtain, and they'll go to the Planning Commission. So certain things like parking impacts and those things, that's what will be considered by the Planning Commission, and they will certainly be tasked with taking that into consideration when looking at that specific project. But for the Historic Resources Commission, it's the conversation needs to remain focused on the historic properties and potential impacts to historic properties.
I have a question, Madam Chair. As this resolution goes forth, where will that be presented to Planning Commission? I mean, or will we vote on it as a commission? What happens to a resolution that we develop for this
good
particular
question.
Matter, number six?
Sure. We would include that in all of our staff information that goes forward to the Planning Commission, and that in turn gets forward to the City Council. So it would be an exhibit to our staff report, essentially, is what it would be.
Okay, thank you.
Commissioner Tarr?
When would this go before the Planning Commission? Is there a date set?
There is not. We are probably several months away.
Thank you.
I just have, I've lived in this community, in the city, since 1969. And I have to go back to the days when, was it the 70s, when we did all of the development into the neighborhood of the apartment buildings. And remember the impact on the community where people were in the apartments looking down in the homes and the activity of the residents and the community where these apartment buildings were and which were totally not congruent as far as, that lifestyle. So what happened with it? The whole areas where you had this, where the apartments and the homes were, it denigrated. We went in, high crime, parking, low income came in, the properties were not maintained. And I am thinking that this can't happen to a historical area with those beautiful homes, and one of the gateways into Santa Ana is Park Santiago in there. How could we totally go back to that time when, you put up these apartments and our whole community collapsed? Our whole community, the structures. We had problems ever since there. And it tore down the values of the property and caused other police activity, no parking. People were leaving, okay? Good people were leaving our city, folks. So I, too, am with the commissioners in saying, we can't go back to the 70s. I know you weren't here, Vince. But you heard the stories. You heard those stories, and you see what I'm talking about. So I, too, Ryan, we've got to protect and let our voice known. We do want to protect the livability of the Park Santiago building so that it isn't damaged by any development that would impact on a downward note to that community with all those historic homes. So I'm throwing it to you. How do we do this?
Madam Chair, I have another comment. What you just were talking about ties into the history of our SDs and historic districts. Those were both triggered, well, two that I know, Henninger Park and French Park were triggered by the demolition and or building of higher-rise apartments. And I believe Park Santiago never, as a neighborhood, took that step to become a district or to have an historic overlay because, we felt they were insulated because they were so nice and historic and cohesive, and now we're finding that it's kind of starting all over again. So I don't know what the answers are. Thank you.
Okay.
Madam.
Okay.
I was just going to comment that I would hope the staff would be painfully aware of the problems that we've had in, like, French Park. I'm glad you mentioned that. And where old homes were torn down. And in this case, they're not proposing to tear any down that I'm aware of. But still, building these big block apartments immediately adjacent to single-family homes has proven in our city to not be a good combination and to hurt property values, to hurt the quality of neighborhoods. So I would hope that staff would work with this applicant of the development to try and help them to see something that would be more appropriate at that site that would be more friendly to the immediate neighbors. I fully expect the Planning Commission will do their job, but they're not looking at it through our eyes of historic resources. And they may not see the impact of property owners that are immediately adjacent to a 5 to 8 story building. And just as a point of reference, in the last 2 months, I've sold 3 homes already of people that live in that immediate area. Melanie lives in that neighborhood, so she knows. But people are worried and they want to get out and they're very upset in Park San Diego, and I don't blame them.
Madam Chair, let me offer this up to the commission. We hear your comments. I've got a list of your comments and concerns. Let me put together some bullet points for you to take a look at. I'll get back to you next week or so. I'll work with the city attorney to be sure we draft proper language, which we can come back and put it together. And if you like the bullet points and you can say yes, go with it, we'll put together some kind of resolution for you to look at your next meeting.
Our next meeting is?
It's February. We'll talk about that at the end of the.
Okay.
February 22nd, tentatively scheduled.
Okay. Okay. Because I have April 5th.
That's the regular meeting?
That's the regular meeting, but we have special meetings.
Right, you can call back in November. Right. Melanie and her team sent out a list of potential dates. So,
mm-hmm.
Okay. So if that's my idea is okay with you, let me put some bullet points together for you to look
at. So do I direct you as
staff? So directed. Got it.
Directing you.
Madam Chair, I do have one more comment. So moving on down the line as historic overlays were made with French Park and Henninger Park, then what happened was, as a protection for building apartment buildings within the neighborhoods, then what happened down the road was infill was looked at very closely. Vacant lots in Henninger Park, I don't know, and in French Park. French Park took the road of moving in homes, historic homes, on their vacant lots, and then Henninger Park didn't have that opportunity. We spent several years exploring what to do with infill, and then in the end, we got apartment buildings that were just 2 stories on a street that did have some 2-story structures, with not so many units. I forgot what the word is for that. But so moving down, once a neighborhood was recognized as historic, then the infill and the new construction was looked at really closely. And that kind of is the same kind of thing. So anyway, that's that information.
Okay. All right. Staff have been directed to come in and give us some points as far as this resolution, and it will come back to us at our special meeting or
your next meeting. I'll have it ready for you. Okay. You'll have something next week
the next meeting of that of our commission for that. All right, now moving on, we have a work study session on discussion regarding the 2018 annual objectives.
Thank you, Madam Chair. And just as a note, of the 2 items that are listed here under the study session, we would like to continue item number 8 for a future meeting, give it a little extra time to discuss that, and that is number 8 is historic resources evaluation practices. And that has to do a little bit, just for a quick second, on we have gotten a couple of applications, which we talked about before, where they're not exemplary examples of architecture. So we want to vet that with the commission so we are all on the same page as far as the threshold of putting everyone on the list or having sort of a threshold of defining exemplary. So that that we would postpone for another time. So getting back to number seven, Happy New Year. And in light of the new year, we'd like to present for discussion these 17 points for the Historic Resources Commission and the Planning Division to be objectives for the coming year. So does everyone have a copy of those? They should be at your dais. So the intention tonight would be to just go through them, and they're in draft mode, and once again at our next meeting we could adjust them based on your feedback and such. So did everyone find their copy?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, wonderful. So I'll just read through them. We can all read through it together. So the first one is complete historic application backlog for property listings and Mills Act agreements. So we presently have 29. The next one would be reinstate the Historic Preservation Awards Program. And we would like to bring at one of the next few meetings a recommendation for how that would proceed. It would be based on prior years and maybe narrowing the scope a little bit, giving staff resources, but that is suggested to be on the objectives. The other one, number three, is to thoroughly reevaluate our Mills Act program. That would be looking at the fees, submittal deadlines, evaluation criteria, potentially, for when it's appropriate to have a Mills Act agreement or different ways to look at it, and also the whole site inspection that's required by state law. So as part of this, we would be surveying other communities and looking at other best practices to share that with the commission so we could vet that thoroughly. So if you'd like to stop and talk along the way, that's feel free to interject. The next two are objectives that are actually currently in our housing element as implementation programs. So the first one is explore innovative strategies to preserve residential districts and neighborhoods that have historic value. So that's kind of broad, but the idea would be to focus on what are the other innovative strategies out there that can help, be it adjacent development or the historic properties themselves. Number five is create guidelines to identify the process for neighborhoods to pursue becoming a type of a historic district. Number six would be, as part of our comprehensive general plan update, our intention is to have a historic element, and that the commission would be involved in providing input and guidance on the goals, policies, and programs. So that's intended for this year as well. Number seven, we've touched on before. It's amending the city's zoning, the ordinance amendment, doing a zoning ordinance amendment so that French Park and Henninger Park, who presently go through planning commission for major exterior modifications, that it be redirected so they come to the Historic Commission. When the code was written, the Historic Commission was not in place, so it seems like a good time to shift that. Number eight would be to affirm the policy and procedures for approval of certificate of appropriateness. So you reviewed a certificate of appropriateness tonight, and just to reaffirm the where staff can administratively make those approvals, which we can now through prior authority when it's like-to-like and minor modifications, and just kind of reaffirm where that line is drawn. The commission actually approved a resolution that defined that, so we'd want to bring it back to you, make sure that it's still relevant. But basically, it's only the major additions and modifications that come to you right now. So the next one, number nine, has been brought up a couple times, and it's doing some educational outreach, whatever that might be, for our historic resources. So that could be a brochure, some outreach to properties or owners in French Park and the downtown historic district, Henninger Park, which is technically a zoning district, and our local properties to have them better understand what does it mean to be on the historic list, If I want to make improvements to my house, where do I go? Who do I talk to? And some of the responsibilities related to that. And we've experienced that in French Park. Folks have said, oh, I didn't know I was on, I had a special review or anything. So try and just get the word out, be it through flyers, be it through realtors. So the idea is to focus on that need. So number 10 would be to create a handout for the design standards for the voluntary placement of historic property plaques. So we touched on that Floral Park has been proactive in providing that information, encouraging that, and we would just follow up with a flyer that affirms the details on it. And the information that Floral Park is giving out is accurate. We would just give, there's just a little bit more detail we would provide. Then the next one is to actually evaluate the benefits of a Historic Resources Commission ad hoc committee. And that we had that years past, and it would be related to reviewing the DPR forms, the historic forms. And as we've experienced, there's some commissioners that have a special background, et cetera, that as we're looking through the history on projects, that is an opportunity to sort of provide input and refine that before it comes to the full commission. So there's pros and cons to that, and so we would evaluate and talk to the commission to see if we'd want to pursue that. The next one is kind of administrative. It's just us update our historic application forms, make them more user-friendly, clear, make sure that what we're asking for we really need, just really update those appropriately. And then the next one would be to improve our historic preservation webpage. So if you go to the webpage now, it's got the information, but it could be a little bit more user-friendly and kind of refine that. The next one is key, and it's actually required as part of being a CLG, keeping our CLG status, and that is to focus on having training for not only staff but the Historic Commission on the responsibilities and the Secretary of Interior standards. Just three more to go here. The next one is we would like to create an interactive GIS historic properties map. And in talking to our GIS folks, it's not that far from being able to do that. So you'd be able to interact with it and click on a property. It would tell you what the architectural style is, when it was built, just all the good basics. So that's on the list. Then two more is the City Library Division right now has an oral history program. And we'd like to connect with them, collaborate with them, and see where there's opportunities to expand that oral resources. So, for instance, if commission identified a particular person that would be a great resource for that, or maybe one of the commissioners, then we coordinate with the library to have that done. And then last but not least, complete our CLG annual report. So that's the report that's required to keep us in that special status that allows us to get grants, et cetera. And in fact, we're working on that report now, and at the next commission meeting, we'll be sharing that with you. So it's a lot to cover, and it feels ambitious, but it's a lot of these things we really need to inch towards if we're gonna be a high quality preservation program. So, I'll just open it up to discussion, and once again, we can bring this back at the next meeting and finalize it as appropriate. Or
I want to thank you for all your work and due diligence that you've done putting this together. I think this is very impressive. I just would like, since our two commissioners, Wynn and Rush, are not here, could you please send this to them so that they know what we discussed today, what are the 17 bullet points that we had in this discussion regarding the 2018 annual objectives. I think that they should have this before our next meeting or whenever you want, just to get their input also.
Sure.
Okay.
And then, Ryan, for this particular list, is there anything that the commission would take action on, or it's just sort of just general?
Not at this point. It's just a work study session. And then, since it is annual objectives, I think that's something that could just be voted on to finalize.
Does any of the commissioners have any questions or comments?
Great work.
Great work.
Yeah, it's very exciting.
Very great.
A lot of the things we've been asking for are on this list, so thank you for listening and incorporating them.
Absolutely.
Very good.
Very good. We're already above average Historic Resource Commission, and this will put us even higher on the ranking out there for Historic Commission. Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
Okay, now we come to staff member comments.
Just one. Got some emails back about the 22nd of February meeting. It sounds like the chair and vice chair may be unavailable at that meeting, so maybe we'll take a look at moving that maybe another week or two into March. So we'll send another email and just check on a date in early March. And so we'll probably end up canceling the one in February, the one in March, to move this February to March, and we'll keep the April one. So anyway, so we'll be looking for an email from Sarah on Monday. Thank you.
Yeah, there's nothing like conflicts, right? They keep us on our toes. Okay. Any other staff comments? Okay. Now we bring it to commission members' comments. We're going to start with you, Mike. Welcome back.
Thank you, Chair Christie. I'd just like to say I'm very glad to be back on the Historic Resources Commission as a representative from the Community Redevelopment and Housing Commission. I really enjoy being on the Historic Resources. I'm a longtime Santa Ana resident, and my family is our longtime Santa Ana residents, and we've lived in some historic neighborhoods and homes, the family has, throughout the years. So I'm really glad to be back with the commission and folks I know.
Commissioner Hardy.
I just want to congratulate all our applicants and welcome Mike back to the Historic Commission. And I do have a question for staff. Is this something that we still provide the applicants or Mills Act recipients?
That was a wonderful thing that we packaged a number of years back, and we don't provide that to the applicants now because it needs to be updated. So that could be something that in that one objective about the educational outreach that we need to go back and see what we can reuse or repackage, because that was the package that we used to give out when folks were placed on the list, and it gave them some good basic information.
And maybe in particular, there's several informative flyers, but this one has incentives. So maybe update incentives if there's some new kind of information. All right, thank you.
Yes, we'll follow up on that. Thank you.
Okay. Commissioner Schaefer?
I'd just like to welcome Mike Tardif back. It's good to have you back. And also to welcome Pedro Gomez. So thank you for joining the efforts of the staff on our behalf. We appreciate that. And looking forward to this year, and love all these objectives that you presented, Melanie. I think they're great. If we can accomplish that, we'll have a very successful year. Thank you.
Ed?
I just want to congratulate all the homeowners. Thank the staff very much. Welcome, Commissioner Tardif. Wonderful to have you back. Also thank Selena and Pedro for presenting. It's great to see new presenters and fresh blood in the in the planning commission, planning department, and that's it. Thank you.
Commissioner Heather Dale.
Okay, well, I want to welcome Mike back also, and welcome Pedro, and thanks for the presentation. I'm really impressed by this agenda. It's very, very ambitious.
Mike, welcome.
Thank you.
And Pedro? We're not scary, are we? You did very well on your presentation. And so did Celine. We did. Thank you. And thank you, staff, for all your hard work that you do. Audience, you don't know how much work they put into, especially when we have our meetings and the detail and all the checking of information facts, and also including, like we said, we welcome you and your stories. So we can add it, as you saw, like Ms. Hunter on your property. You gave us a lot of information that we didn't have, and we're going to be checking that out. And that's what it is. We want to know, you know, we welcome you as neighbors, and we thank you for preserving the treasures that we have here in Santa Ana. So congratulations to all of you. And I just want to remind everyone, make an announcement, that we're going to do a presentation to our city council. The Historic Resource Commission, Commissioner Rushy and Schaefer and I will be there at the meeting on February 6th. Is that the date, Tuesday? Tuesday, to educate them what we do. I don't think they know exactly how hard we work or what we do, you know, as far as a commission. So please join us or tune in to hear this wonderful presentation that we put together for our council members, okay? And with that, I'm going to our next regularly scheduled meeting would be Thursday, April 5th at 4:30 p.m. With special, how do I do this? We know we gotta have a special meeting.
Right, just adjourn it to the next meeting, it's fine.
Just adjourn it to the next regularly, which is April 5th at 4:30 here, and special meetings will be, you know, coming prior to that, okay? Is there a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
By Tardif, second? Second by Hibbertdale. Motion to adjourn. Okay, thank you so much. I know. But look how much information and knowledge we got on there. Staff did great. This is so impressive. Looking at my brain, I'm going, you know, with these maps, and I'm going, but this is Main Street. And turned to,
okay.
You know, I got so great. Thank you guys for helping me out.
Thanks for inviting me.
Yeah, because I just got so confused. I'm looking at this, you know, but this is Main Street, right?